Welcome to the Knife Junkie Podcast, your weekly dose of knife news and information about knives and knife collecting. Here's your hosts, Jim Person and Bob the Knife Junkie DeMarco.
Well, hello, fellow Knife Junkie, and welcome to episode number 59 of the Knife Junkie Podcast. I'm Jim Person.
And I'm Bob the Knife Junkie DeMarco. Welcome to the podcast.
The podcast is the place where you, knife newbie or a knife junkie, can learn everything you need to know about knives and knife collecting by hearing from the makers, the designers, the manufacturers, the YouTube reviewers, whoever it is, the movers and the shakers of the knife industry. We like to talk to them, and we get to hear those interviews right here on the Knife Junkie Podcast, our weekend edition. And Bob, another good interview for us coming up today. You want to tease that just a little bit?
Yeah, we speak to another knife hero of mine, Michael Janich. He's the designer of the Spyderco Yojimbo, the Spyderco Ronin, and the famed Spyderco Yojimbo 2, of which I have two. And he's also the creator of Martial Blade Concepts, a form of martial arts and knife fighting and knife self-defense that he cobbled together through years of experience in a myriad of Filipino martial arts. So it's well-informed knife self-defense. And very interesting talking to him. He's a very analytical guy. So it's interesting to hear about these kind of topics from an analytical perspective.
Quick question for you. You mentioned in that tease, that intro, if you will, that you had two of the Yojimbo 2 models. So if a knife has a number in it, like 3 or 4 or 5, does that mean you have to buy that number of knives that's in the title?
I think it does. And you know what? One of my favorite knives is the Hinderer XM24.
Oh, my.
Yeah.
So How many of those do you have?
I only have two, so I better get moving on that.
Well, at least you took one of the numbers, you know. So, all right. Hey, we've got some other exciting news, though, before we want to get into the Michael Janich interview. Some things we've been kicking around for a while, but you want to spill the beans on what's going to be happening later this week on YouTube?
We're calling it Thursday Night Knives, a live knife show at 10 p.m. We're going to have guest hosts. We're going to have just a bit of banter and a lot of high production value. It's going to be a beautiful YouTube show.
And it's not going to have me. So,
no, you're going to be working your sorcery behind the scenes. There's some stuff Jim's very excited to be doing, and I'm very excited to be a part of it.
Yeah, well, and I'm excited for it because it's going to truly be, you know, the knife junkies getting together, talking, and you know, just some of the things that you've got planned. You know, like a weekly or, you know, a regular battle of the knives kind of feature, but you know, kind of doing specific topics for each show. So again, that's coming up this Thursday. It's going to be November the 14th. And as Bob said, 10 p.m. Eastern time, Thursday Night Knives on YouTube. So this is your chance. If you are not yet subscribed to the Knife Junkie YouTube channel, please go and do that now, because that way you'll get notified when the Knife Junkie goes live. Go to thenifejunkie.com/YTsubscribe. And that way you don't miss any episodes of Thursday Night Knives or any of Bob's knife review videos and that kind of thing.
Jim, I keep thinking of this show like a news pundit show where you see a couple of windows popping up and you see people getting in the weeds about things as important as lock bar interface and things as important as steel compositions and really, really getting into the weeds.
All right. There you heard it. Let's listen for it and watch for it on YouTube. Thursday Night Knives live on YouTube.
You're listening to the Knife Junkie Podcast. Call the Knife Junkie at 724-466-4487 with your questions or comments.
I'm here with Michael Janich, famed combatives knife expert and designer of the Yojimbo 2 by Spyderco, very famous Spyderco knife. Michael, thank you for joining us on the Knife Junkie Podcast.
Thank you for the opportunity. I appreciate it.
Oh, it's my pleasure. As we mentioned before we started rolling, you're the designer of pretty much my favorite all-time Spyderco knife, and I have a few of them. And I know that you have optimized this knife design for self-defense. It's a great utility EDC knife, but it's also optimized for self-defense. And the thing I wanted to ask you first and foremost is, when I think of fighting knife, I think of Oftentimes I think of something long, slender, and stabby, or something recurved with a lot of belly or a sweep. Why did you choose that Warncliffe-style blade, that sack style?
What it really comes down to is when you consider a knife for self-defense, the first rule that in my system, martial blade concepts, what I teach right up front is the logic of self-defense when it comes to knives. And one of the main things that people need to accept is that you are going to fight with the knife you actually carry. So you can look at fighting knife design and you can kind of go off in the weeds theoretically, or if you weren't bound by any kind of legal considerations, if you're designing something for a military application, for a battlefield type of thing, or for a martial arts application, you can do whatever you want. But when you start looking at the laws, then what you have to look at is what are the blade length considerations I need to be concerned about, and what can I realistically carry on a daily basis? So you look at something that is convenient, something that is practical, something that's legal, and then you say, okay, now based on those parameters, I want to design a knife and I want to come up with a blade style that allows me to get as much cutting performance, as much destructive capacity as I can, given the limitations of what I've got to work with. And that's where the Warncliffe really shines.
So why is that? You think of a big sweeping, upswept scimitar as something that can shear with great efficiency. The Warncliffe is kind of the opposite in terms of blade shape and geometry. Why did you? What's that about?
The simplest way to explain it is it cuts with full power all the way to the tip. So when you think of that, the human body is built to move in arcs. Okay, so all of our joints are basically designed to allow us to move in arcs. So when you're cutting with a knife, even if you try to make it as straight a motion as possible, it's still going to be some type of an arcing motion. So what you have to think about is the blade is the end of that arc, and it's basically trying to define the end of the radius of movement. Well, if you have anything that has belly to it, what ends up happening is the arc of motion of your arm and ultimately the curve of the upswept point will run parallel. And once something is running parallel, it's no longer applying pressure into the wound. It's no longer cutting any deeper. So when you think about utility knives, when you think about X-Acto knives, these are things that are designed to cut with full power all the way to the point. And the Warncliffe does exactly the same thing. No matter where you make contact on the edge, it's going to cut with full power and will continue to cut with full power until it reaches the very tip. There's no point where that upward sweep starts to diminish the force that you're applying into the wound.
That's actually beautifully stated. I intuitively understand the concept, but whenever I try and describe that, you get full power all the way to the tip. And so something about the Yojimbo too, I always kind of thought it was a wolf in sheep's clothing in that it was the kind of knife that I could pull out of my pocket. And if I needed to justify why I had it, I could say, well, it's a work knife because it looks like a work knife. It looks like you mentioned a large X-Acto knife, but it's got that wicked hollow grind and it's got that perfect handle and that thumb swell. It is really optimized for gripping tightly and using.
And I also use one for utility purposes all the time. So what's great about the Warncliffe style is if you want to cut with power, most of the power cutting you're going to do is at the heel of the edge, so closest to the handle. Mm-hmm. That's where you'll have the most leverage and you can cut with full force. If you need something that has more of like a scalpel type precision, then you simply choke up on the blade and use the tip. So it literally gives you that flexibility as a utility knife as well. You can do everything from picking a splinter to cutting with full force, and it does all that and does it equally well.
So before I was mentioning intuitively, I have my intuition has certain ideas of what the perfect self-defense blade shape would be. And like I said, it harkens back to bowies and Persian-style blades and dramatic upswept. Yet the Vikings used a sax or a scramasax. I can't remember. Yes. As their, not only their everyday tool, their everyday carry knife just for utility, but they also use that obviously in fighting. So it should be no surprise that Warncliffes are not, I don't know if you're aware of this, but after the Yojimbo 2 came out, everything was Warncliffe for a while. Everyone wanted a Warncliffe blade and it kind of seemed like a little bit like fashion, but really it's turned out that these knives are great for everything.
Well, what's interesting is when you look at kind of the tactical Warncliffe without being, patting myself on the back, that has been kind of a cause that I've been pushing for a long time. When you go back to my very first Spyderco designs, which were the Spyderco Ronin and the first generation Yojimbo. When I first had a chance to design a knife, it was actually with Masters of Defense Knife Company way back in late 1997, came out in 1998, and I designed a knife in a lot of ways kind of based on what you were just saying a moment ago, which is, hey, I think of a Bowie knife, I think of something that has to have belly to the edge, and all of these things that were common wisdom, or so we thought, based on repeating what we were told. So I designed that knife. It came out great. It was called the Tempest for Masters of Defense. And it was a great opportunity. I was very proud of it. When I had an opportunity actually to design a knife for a custom knife maker by the name of Mike Snowdy, he asked me to design something. And Mike said, you know, hey, I want you to design the ultimate neck knife. What I had started doing in my Marshall Blade Concepts teaching, again, I focus very heavily on the logic. So the first element of logic is you'll fight with the knife you actually carry. The second element of that logic is that you have to be able to quantify the destructive capacity of your actual carry knife. What can it do? What kind of damage can it cause? So one of the things that I started doing was I created a target called Pork Man. It's basically you get about a 5 pound, ideally 5 pound if you can get it, pork tenderloin or pork roast. You butterfly it, wrap it around a piece of dowel rod, tie it on with a bunch of butcher's twine, and wrap it with about 30 layers of saran wrap. So what you have is something that pretty closely replicates like a human bicep, tricep, the upper part of the forearm, or the lower part of the thigh, which are the primary targets we go after. Then you would put some denim over the top of that, and you'd cut. And what that allows you to do is to take the knife you actually carry and quantify its destructive ability. So what I started doing before I designed that knife for Mike Snowdy was I pulled out everything I had in my collection, bought a bunch of pork, fired up the barbecue at the same time, and basically did a bunch of pork man testing and as scientifically as possible tried to quantify how different blade shapes cut. And the knife that actually cut the best out of my collection was a Spyderco, but it was actually one of the old Senafonte models.
Oh, yeah.
So when you look at the Senafonte design, it's a Warncliffe design. And I was trying to figure out, okay, why does this thing cut better? And I started looking at the mechanics. I started looking, laying blades side by side, overlaying one over the other. And what I realized is as soon as you have that belly sweeping upward, especially on a short knife, what ends up happening is that curve runs parallel to the curve of motion of your arm. And at that point, you diminish the power of the cut. So that was what really kind of inspired me to start exploring the Warncliffe design that led to my original Snowdy Ronin design, which was a custom knife. Then Spyderco picked that up as a fixed blade. Sal Glesser then said, hey, we need to do a folding knife because we're primarily known for folders. So I designed the first generation Yojimbo. And back then, people would look at it and it was just like, what the hell is this? This is, you know, this is not a tactical knife. This doesn't look right. And it's been a number of years, really, a consistent effort through some of my knife designs and through education and teaching, getting people to embrace that. Once they cut with them, once they see the effects of the cut, that's what converts people. But at first, they find it strange that the Warncliffe would be the blade of choice. But again, it's based on lots of live blade cutting tests.
If you don't mind my saying, the Yojimbo 2 versus the Yojimbo 1, I'm speaking strictly aesthetically, but I can extrapolate just from holding the Yojimbo 2 and how amazing it feels. It seems like the Yojimbo 2 is definitely a more elegant and nuanced and effective version of the first design.
That's definitely true. You know, and that's why the second generation designs, that's why, ideally we get better with everything we do. Mm-hmm. If we're not, we're doing something wrong. So the whole idea is that you learn from your experience, you learn from the shortcomings of what you may have done before, and you try to make it better the second time around. And yeah, I agree completely. Yojimbo 2 is a much more evolved, much more refined design.
It's, like I said, my favorite Spyderco. So when I think of Marshall Blade Concepts, I think of some of the earlier videos I saw with you, and I think of the comma cut, the C cut to the thigh. Tell me about Marshall Blade Concepts and where it comes from, what your background is.
When I first got involved in the martial arts back when I was a teenager, the thing that scared me the most when we started training was being attacked by somebody with a knife. It seemed the most unpredictable. It was the hardest to deal with. And the techniques that we were learning really were not very practical. So we would learn these techniques. We'd get good at them. We'd try to torture test them and pressure test them in our training. but they really didn't work very well. So I went to my instructor and I said, look, our counter knife techniques suck. I want to learn something better. And his response was, if you want to learn how to defend against a knife, learn how to use the knife. I'm like, okay, that makes perfect sense. Let's do some knife fighting. And this is mid-1970s. Really, all that was around at that time was kind of legacy World War II stuff, a lot of the historical stuff that was out there. And then there were two books that came out in mid-1970s. It was The Complete Book of Knife Fighting and Secrets of Modern Knife Fighting by David Steele. When those came out, read them cover to cover, was trying to learn as much as possible. Soldier of Fortune magazine came out. David Steele was writing articles for them. And I was trying to do as much research as I could. Had some fellow students. We got together and we would spar with knives. We'd beat the snot out of each other with the old wooden Tonto knives and stuff like that. But there was really nothing out there that I could find that was a good organized curriculum as far as learning how to use a knife defensively. And then I heard about the Filipino martial arts. So it's like, okay, this has to be the mother load of information. They're supposed to have all this great edge weapon, you know, skills and everything. By this time, I was in the Army. I joined the Army and actually ended up being stationed in Hawaii, where there's a large Filipino population. So I figured, okay, I'm in a great place to be able to pursue this. I went to the Filipino Chamber of Commerce, said, hey, I'm, you know, U.S. military stationed here in Hawaii. I'm looking for an instructor in the Filipino martial arts. They gave me several names. I started calling around. And as soon as I expressed any interest in knife stuff, they'd hang up.
Oh, wow.
Nobody wanted to teach me any knife because I was not Filipino. It was something that they reserved for their culture, and they would not teach outside their culture. So in researching the arts, the Filipino martial arts are based on the idea of using the same basic mechanics, the same techniques, but adapting to the attributes of the weapon. So I was an intelligence analyst for the military. I said, okay, fine. Let me learn their stick stuff because they would actually teach stick, and I had one instructor who accepted me to learn stick. Started learning that and adapting that to knife and adapting that to the attributes of the knife. So there was a long analytical process where I was basically taking Filipino stick work, trying to express that with a knife, and trying to learn as much as I could from, you know, whatever little tidbits I could find. And then years later, when I finally got to work with people who had learned the Filipino knife arts firsthand, they're looking at me saying, where did you get your knife stuff? And I said, well, you know, certainly didn't get it from Filipino instructors because they weren't forthcoming with it at that point. And they're like, well, this is legit. This is solid. And I started teaching a little bit, started sharing some of that. And the most interesting things that I ran into, one of the turning points for me, really, I was working for Paladin Press. I'd run Paladin Press's video production department for 10 years and had written a book on knife fighting, essentially the book that I wanted back when I was first learning knife fighting, a practical course. And I was contacted by a guy who had been attacked by his boss. His boss attacked him with a knife. He defended himself, disarmed the boss. The boss grabbed him by the throat and was trying to strangle him. This guy grabbed the knife, and they fought for about 5 minutes. In the process, he stabbed his boss over 50 times.
Damn.
With a 6-inch blade. And this guy was basically arrested for first-degree murder. And he said, I want you to help me in preparing my case, my defense, as far as my claim of self-defense. So I had access to all the coroner's reports, I had access to the police reports, all the forensic evidence and everything else. So I took my analytical skills and I sat down and I went through this. And in the process, what I realized, this guy had a 6-inch blade and he has run it into this guy's torso repeatedly and the guy's not stopping. So a lot of what I thought I knew as far as, you know, the common knowledge of knife stuff, you stick somebody in the torso, they burst into flames and you're done. That's what I thought knife stuff was all about. This totally disproved all that. And I realized that the human body is a lot more resilient than we give it credit for. And especially if you're trying to stop somebody with a knife, the conventional way of doing it was all wrong. So what I did was I took my Filipino martial arts knowledge. I then went to the medical community and started to work with trauma surgeons, started to work with physical therapists who work with people who had industrial accidents and things like that. Busted out Gray's Anatomy and dug into that and tried to understand how the human body works, then based on the knife I could actually carry, the type of destructive capacity I have for that knife, and then essentially the scale of the human body, what parts do I need to cut to shut people down effectively and decisively? So that's kind of where NBC came from.
That's brilliant. That came from your analytical mind. That came
right.
To me, that reminds me of the thought that you only really know how to hurt someone, whether it's physically or psychologically, once you realize and admit to yourself how vulnerable you are psychologically and physically. It's only through knowing what your own limitations are that you can kind of transpose that onto someone else and use it to defend yourself or hurt them, you know, offensively or defensively.
Exactly. You understand vulnerabilities. You also understand your destructive capacity. So going again back to the core logic of NBC, you'll fight with the knife you actually carry. You have to understand the destructive capacity of that knife. You need to accept the fact that stopping power is your goal. Lethality is secondary. Although you're authorized and justified in using lethal force, what it comes down to is if you don't stop that person and they kill you, a mutual slaying isn't good enough. You need to be able to stop that attack decisively. And then what you have to do is understand human anatomy. So you take that destructive capacity of the knife. You say, okay, now I understand the human body. What parts do I need to cut or puncture to be able to achieve that instantaneous stop?
So you use the term stopping power, which is something I hear used with firearms frequently. A 45 has stopping power, you know, lay them right down. So what does that mean with a knife, especially after you tell me the story about a man who stabbed his assailant 50 times before the guy would stop? What is stopping power with a knife?
Well, first of all, the fact that you've heard it many times is exactly why I use the term. Mm-hmm. So when it comes to self-defense, when it comes to, again, the practicalities of modern self-defense, first of all, you have to solve the problem, which is you have to stay alive and survive the attack. Secondly, you have to be able to justify your actions legally. So when we look at the legal requirements for self-defense, you're basically allowed to use a commensurate level of force. So if somebody throws a punch at you, you can throw a punch back. If somebody pulls a lethal weapon, then you're justified in crossing that bridge and drawing a lethal weapon yourself. That's the only time when you're in fear of death or grievous bodily injury, that's when you're justified in using a lethal weapon. When it comes to stopping power, because that is the legal requirement, that's also the term that we want to ingrain in our students, and it's what we want to always express as our intent in defending ourselves. What were you trying to do? I was trying to stop the assailant. I wasn't trying to kill him. I wasn't trying to bleed him. I wasn't trying to, there was no other intent there other than to stop him. Now, going back to the mechanics of that process with a knife, what's interesting about it is when you look at the Filipino martial arts, there's a tactic that's commonly used called defanging the snake. So when you think of the arm as being a snake and the hand holding the weapon basically represents the fang of the snake. So defanging the snake means that you would essentially cut the forearm. Typically what you're actually targeting is the flexor tendons of the wrist or the flexor muscles on the inside of the forearm. And you're basically disconnecting the mechanical connection that allows the hand to close. So muscles pull on tendons to move bones. If you can actually sever the tendons or sever the muscles deeply enough, mechanically, that process stops. And at that point, the hand would open, the weapon would fall. So in the Filipino martial arts, in their battlefield, in traditional application, the idea is defang the snake, which means that you literally disarm your attacker, and then you kill him. From a self-defense standpoint, that goes from lawful self-defense to assault with a deadly weapon to murder.
Yes.
So when you look at even people who train in the Filipino martial arts in the traditional sense, and they say, oh, I'm going to apply this in modern self-defense. Well, we've all heard the saying, you'll fight the way you train. Well, if you actually train that way, you may be very skilled, but you may not have the presence of mind to be able to stop once you've disarmed your attacker. So at that point, you now have an unarmed person who no longer represents a lethal threat, and you continue to cut and thrust and do everything else that you've trained to do that essentially kills that person at that point. So now you've gone beyond the limitations of reasonable self-defense, and you end up in prison.
That's a really interesting conundrum there, because when you're training, you don't want to stop early with the thought that, you know, you don't want to stop your technique now because this guy might still have juice. He might still come after you. You want to keep moving until the threat has stopped. But when you're training, everything's hypothetical. You know, you don't really actually see the effects of this hypothetical cut or that hypothetical cut or thrust. And once you have them on the ground and their wrist is locked up and you continue to, you know, sever the arm and stab into the neck or whatever else you're doing, you're practicing that so that you keep flowing until that threat has stopped. But like I said, that's hypothetical. In a real life situation, one little cut might change the tide of everything.
Exactly. And again, when you look at modern self-defense, how many people are going to be out there with cell phones? How many surveillance cameras might there be? So, you know, you can try to say that, oh, I did this and this and this, but there may be video evidence there, and they're going to be analyzing that. They're going to look at every frame of that video and say, okay, at this point, what were you thinking? At this point, what were you thinking? And what you need to do is to focus on the idea of stopping. So what I do in NBC, again, looking at the medical side of it, because there's a lot of misinformation out there as far as the medical aspects of using a knife in self-defense at all. Well, a lot of it goes back to W.E. Fairburn and Get Tough, the original timetable of death. There was huge misinformation in that. Basically, all of that is crap. With all due respect to his memory and everything, there's no scientific basis for anything that was in the timetable of death. So what I did was I basically looked at it in simple terms, and I said, okay, if defanging the snake works because mechanically you're cutting muscles or you're cutting tendons, then let's extend that same process to other body parts. So what we do is we consider essentially the flexor tendons and the flexor muscles of the forearm to be the first target priority. And the reason that's first is if somebody's extending a weapon toward you, they're giving you that target. Mm-hmm. So you don't have to work for it. The second target priority is the bicep and tricep. So essentially what you have are the muscles that bend and flex or bend and extend the elbow. So what that gives you is the muscles that control articulated motion of the arm that allows someone to wield a weapon effectively. And then the real go-to shot is the quadricep muscle at the front of the thigh just above the knee. Mm-hmm. And that's what extends the knee joint and allows somebody to support weight. So we call that basically a mobility kill. If you cut that quadricep muscle, they cannot support weight anymore. They drop to one knee, and at that point you can create distance and create safety.
So here's a question with that technique in particular, actually. I like that because it stops, you know, kind of like defanging the snake. You're defanging the whole snake. If the guy can't get to you.
Yeah, just looking for more fangs.
Right, exactly. But I know that there are, and I don't know my anatomy that well, but I know that there are some big arteries in those thighs. I take it from that, you're just trying to hurt that muscle, but you're not trying to get that artery.
Well, again, what's interesting is NBC has evolved. And one of the things that I've tried to do since I came up with the basic concepts for NBC, it has continued to evolve. As I've, especially as I've taught more and more medical professionals, I've learned more and more. Every time I have an opportunity to teach, for example, teaching for the International School of Tactical Medicine was huge for me because these are trauma surgeons, SWAT doctors. These are the guys that have seen more knife and gunshot wounds than, you know, just about anybody out there. When I had a chance to teach for them, I again asked them, you know, hey, am I off base on anything? Is there anything from, you know, my premise as far as the use of the knife in self-defense that is illogical or it just doesn't hold up scientifically? And they're like, nope, you're definitely on track. But then it was interesting. I worked with a guy who was a neurologist. He was also a class 3 firearms dealer. Interesting combination. But when I was teaching NBC for him, he stopped me along the way and he's like, you know, you're talking all about the muscles and tendons. And he says, you're perfectly accurate as far as that goes. Your knowledge of anatomy is sound. But do you realize what you're doing neurologically? And I'm like, no, please tell me. And he said, well, what you're doing neurologically is nerves basically do two things. One is you have sensory perception. It goes back to the brain. So when you touch something, you feel this is hot, cold, rough, smooth, whatever it is. You have that sensory perception. But of course, the other side is the brain telling the body what to do and specifically telling body parts. Essentially, the brain sends out its electrical impulses. When you want to move your arm, your brain tells the muscles, hey, contract and move the arm. Well, when you cut the nerves, again, what you have is an instantaneous result. And the higher you go on the arm, the higher you go on the limb, the closer you get to the root of that nerve, the more profound the effect. So what we have in NBC are three layers of stopping power, three levels of stopping power. The first is the mechanical level, which is essentially the muscles and the tendons. The second one is a neurological level, which is basically cutting the nerves that now allow the brain to control the muscles. And then the third level is essentially cutting the arteries. So we know that all of those things are co-located. So if you were to cut the bicep, for example, if you cut the bicep and you ended up cutting the inside of the arm, you would also cut essentially the median nerve, the ulnar nerve, the nerve cluster that runs down the arm that innervates all the muscles of the arm and tells it what to do. You'd also take the brachial artery. So one cut would literally give you all three levels of stopping power. But the misconception that people have is the bleed out rate. So what people believe is, and again, a lot of this goes back to Fairburn. Fairburn was wildly exaggerating how short a time period it is from the time that an artery is severed until somebody bleeds out. Again, all of his stuff was not scientifically sound, and it's wildly inaccurate. So what we end up doing, the stopping power, the instantaneous stopping power that we achieve in NBC is based on cutting the muscles and the tendons and the nerves, and then you get time-delayed stopping through exsanguination, essentially bleeding somebody out. Mm-hmm. So we realize and we accept the fact that, you know, all three targets are co-located, but again, we're focusing on specific targets for specific reasons. The arteries are basically ancillary. It's just a byproduct of the rest of the technique.
Okay, so that's not necessarily the goal at all, depending on what level you're going for in terms of stopping power.
We acknowledge it, but we don't count on it.
Got you.
So again, what's interesting when you look at Fairburn stuff, so for example, he would talk about the carotid artery, and this is again where you have huge misconceptions in the martial arts and knife world, because you'll hear cliches like going for the jugular.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, the jugular is a vein. So if you go back to eighth grade biology and you say, okay, veins take deoxygenated blood at low blood pressure back to the heart. Veins actually have check valves in them to help the blood get back to the heart. Then it's run through the heart, run through the lungs, it's oxygenated, and then it's pumped back out into the body under high blood pressure. That's what arteries are. So arteries are what you want to cut if you want to bleed somebody. So the idea of even saying going for the jugular means that you really don't know what you're going for. you're kind of misguided to begin with, because what you would really target if you were cutting the neck is the carotid artery, which is close by, but not the same thing.
Right, right.
Well, according to Fairburn, if you cut the carotid artery, he said that basically 5 seconds later, you'd be unconscious, and 14 seconds later, you'd be dead. That's bullshit.
Okay.
So what it comes down to is you have to look at, first of all, the one side of the carotid artery. The carotid artery is bilateral, so you have one on each side of the neck. One side is basically 7.5% of your blood flow. So at any one point, 7.5% of your total blood volume is flowing through that. What you have to look at is when you lose 20% of your blood volume, you essentially go into shock. At 30%, you go unconscious because there's not enough oxygen going to your brain to keep you conscious. And at 40% blood loss, at that point, you basically don't have enough oxygen going to your brain to keep it alive.
Mm.
And at that point, you start to die. So what you have to think about is, what is your heart rate? How much blood is being pumped out by your heart with each stroke, what's called stroke volume? And then based on the amount of blood that's being lost, in this case, 7.5% with a severed carotid artery, how long does it take you to bleed to 30%, which is where you go unconscious and essentially be functionally stopped?
Right.
At 220 beats per minute, the average person is going to take them about 68 seconds to bleed to unconsciousness from the severed carotid artery. So you've got over a minute that somebody is at arm's length, armed with a lethal weapon, still trying to kill you. You think you're done.
Yeah, with adrenaline, and you're thinking it's 14 seconds. They got another 55 seconds in there that they could
14 seconds, according to Fairburn, was death.
So in the age of the gun, this is a big thing I hear about, because I love the Filipino martial arts, and I love the aesthetics of knife martial arts. I love the concepts behind it. I love the movement. I love training it. And I hear a lot, well, I would just pull out my gun and shoot you. And I say, well, I've got a gun too. That's not the point. But what do you say to people when they question the validity of martial knife training in the age of the gun?
You hear that a lot. You know, the first thing that I say is, okay, do you actually have a concealed carry permit? Well, you know, I've been meaning to get one. I was going to take a class. It's like, okay, great. So basically the only thing you're shooting off is your mouth at the moment. So you're disqualified.
Ooh, that's a good one.
If they have a concealed carry permit, it's like, okay, are you carrying? Do you carry consistently? Well, you know, it's kind of uncomfortable. I'm looking for the right holster. And you get this litany of excuses where it's like, okay, again, back to the logic of defending yourself with any kind of a weapon. Whatever you carry on a daily basis is what you're going to actually use if you're attacked. So if you don't have a gun, if you say, well, I would just shoot him. Okay, great. With what? With the gun that's back in your gun safe? The guy's going to hang out, wait for you to drive home, come back, shoot him. It doesn't work that way. So with the knife, part of the reason that I became so so passionate about knives also was that I lived overseas for about 5 years. Okay. So I lived in Hong Kong, lived in Bangkok, was traveling all over Asia. And even though I was assigned to embassies and consulates over there, I couldn't legally own a firearm because I was a foreign national. I certainly couldn't carry one. And I was working basically in Vietnamese refugee camps and other places around Southeast Asia, many of which were, a lot of their population was actually North Vietnamese gangs. So there were, just like, you know, prisons here, you had a lot of improvised edge weapons, a lot of violence going on in those camps. And I was also traveling alone. I was travel from Hong Kong to the Philippines, spend lots of time in the Philippines on my own. The Philippines at that time was very active with the National People's Army, the NPA, and they were actively targeting Americans. So I looked at it and it's like, okay, I would love to be able to carry a gun. I'd love to be able to defend myself with a gun, but it's simply not allowed. It's not something that I can do. But the knife, I had a diplomatic passport. They never checked my bags. I could carry whatever knife I wanted to. In Thailand, I had a get out of jail free card. It was great as far as knife carry, but the gun simply wasn't an option. And when you look at a lot of people these days, even if they do carry on a regular basis, if you travel, sooner or later, you're going to go to some place where it's a non-permissive environment. You don't have reciprocity. Or if you have to travel overseas, again, you're back to square one.
Yeah. Yeah. I think, obviously gun is a great weapon. And if you have it on you, more power to you, obviously. But, I mean, I have a carry permit and I never carry a gun. It's just too much. And it's not, I'm not quite sure I'm willing to take that on. Whereas I carry multiple knives on me all the time. And maybe it's because I have the training with that. I don't really have tactical gun training. I remember, a seminar with Guru Danny Nosanto. He was talking about, this was right after 9/11. He was talking about how he had to change up his airplane carry. And how he would, he'd carry a drafting kit with him, a nice metal ruler and, some metal mechanical pencils. And he busted them out and started, you know, doing Sinawali with them or whatever and showing how, you know, these are improvised and these are not ideal. But, if they're all you're allowed to have, they will have to do. And if your mindset is strictly projectile, if your mindset is strictly, I will defend myself with a gun because that's the most powerful and efficient weapon out there, and why bother with anything else, you might get caught flat-footed.
And also what it comes down to, even if you have a carry permit, if you are a good shooter from a marksmanship standpoint, do you actually have gunfighting skill? Which means if you have, you know, you'll hear at this point, everyone wants to chime in with, well, the Tooler drill, 21-foot rule, all that kind of stuff. Again, you have to look at the history. So there's huge misconceptions about what the 21-foot rule is. In simple terms, all it was an exercise in relative distance and timing. So Dennis Tooler, when he was teaching his recruits at Salt Lake City PD, basically they said, hey, Sarge, how far away do we have to be if someone comes running at us with a knife? We want to be able to draw and shoot before they reach us. Their qualification course was already 7 yards. So it just so happened that it took the average person about a second and a half to 2 seconds from a standing start to run 7 yards, to sprint that distance. It also took about a second and a half to 2 seconds for them to draw from their duty holster and get around center mass. So what they looked at was, hey, it's about 7 yards to have a mutual slaying. You know, at that point, essentially, he's reaching you at the same time that you're shooting him, and it's a wash. That doesn't mean you win. It doesn't mean that your shots are going to stop him before he gets to you. And really what Dennis Tooler was trying to teach was you need to have other options. You need to be able to move and shoot so that you can create distance. You can move offline. You can, you know, use different tactics to be able to ensure your safety. But what ended up happening was when that was coined as a 21-foot rule, when Masayu broke that up for SWAT magazine, he called it the 21-foot rule. And as soon as it was coined as a rule, then it's like, oh, well, if somebody's got a knife and they're within 21 feet, you get to shoot them. No, that's not really it. And you end up with all these misconceptions. The bottom line is if you look at YouTube, you look at videos of people actually attacking other people with knives and other contact distance weapons, what they do is they move up real close. They get to the point where they can, you know, lunge one or two steps and then attack. That's the reality of the attack. So even if you have a gun, going to your gun initially as your initial response is going to get you killed. What you have to have then are empty-handed skills that allow you to stay alive long enough to earn your draw and then use the gun. And most shooters don't have that. They do ludicrous stuff like speed rocks and all that kind of crap. And what it really comes down to is, again, you're back to that mutual slaying type of thing. There's a lot more to it than just being able to shoot from a marksmanship standpoint.
So describe what Marshall Blade Concepts is, and also, do you integrate guns into that training?
I do. So Marshall Blade Concepts, what it really is, again, it was kind of what I had hoped for 40 years ago when I first got into this stuff, when I really wanted to learn how to use a knife as a practical self-defense weapon, because I didn't have access to anything else. So it really is it's a practical self-defense system that is designed to empower the average person to have skills they can use to defend their life. It also is sophisticated enough and has enough depth to where you can also consider it to be a martial art if you want to pursue it with that mindset. Mm-hmm. So we have a lot of the same training drills you'd have in the Filipino martial arts. We have our specific take on them and our specific interpretation of them. But you can train it as a martial art if you want to, but it all goes back to the defensive application. A brother art of that, and going back to my original inspiration for getting into knives, we also have what's called counterblade concepts, which is the empty hand against knife aspect. And both of those share a lot of the same body mechanics, and both of those also provide a platform for the shooting side of what we do. When I went to work for Paladin Press back in 1994, basically what I was hired to do was to start their video production department, but also work with Colonel Rex Applegate. So Colonel Applegate, for those who don't know who he is, he's basically the close combat trainer for the OSS, the Office of Strategic Services, which is the predecessor of the CIA. So he was personally charged by Wild Bill Donovan, the head of the OSS during World War II, to set up the Military Intelligence Training Center and essentially train all the U.S. spies that we sent overseas during World War II. So he's a close combat legend. When you look at the Applegate Fairburn folding knife, the Applegate Fairburn fixed blade, the Smatchet, there are numerous knife designs out there. And when you go back and look at the Colonel's legacy, I mean, he was legendary, truly. And working with him was a huge privilege. Well, his thing was point shooting. So he believed that kinesthetic alignment of the gun, not using the sights, was the way to go in combat.
Point shooting, does that just refer to literally pointing with your finger, basically? Or?
Well, there again, when you get into the semantics of this, it becomes kind of a deep rabbit hole because all the sighted fire shooters will come out and immediately start saying, you know, that's spray and pray and all this other kind of stuff. When you look at point shooting, the way that I define it is kinesthetic alignment. So what it comes down to is being able to use your natural ability to orient the gun through pointing and through body orientation to be able to get, when you look at the term aiming simply means aligning a weapon with a target. So it's a way of aiming without using the sights. Hmm. And again, that becomes a deep rabbit hole in and of itself. But I had the opportunity to work with Colonel Applegate and also Jim Cirillo. Jim Cirillo was a member of the, NYPD stakeout unit. So he was, as far as contemporary modern gunfighters, he was involved in 17 gunfights, personally killed 12 people.
Damn.
One of the most amazing shots that I'd ever seen. And he was a hardcore sighted fire shooter, but he also believed in kinesthetic alignment and the ability to shoot the gun using what he called alternative sighting methods. But a lot of what I do as far as my approach to shooting handguns is based on what I learned from Colonel Applegate and Jim Cirillo. It's a little bit of a hybrid that is combined with the body mechanics from NBC and CBC.
That doesn't surprise me about the kinesthetic alignment concept, because if you're playing a game, racquetball or whatever, you're not thinking before you hit the ball. Your body is reacting, your body is thinking, and then maybe on analysis afterwards, your mind catches up. But really, you know, especially if you have any sort of expertise in a given area, a physical area, like maybe martial arts, you're not thinking before you intercept that knife. You're doing, and then later kind of reconsidering. So that sort of, alignment without the sights makes sense to me as a non-tactical shooter. That sort of makes sense to me.
Well, an easy way to think of it, have you seen the Weaver stance? So the Weaver stance is basically where you have one arm is bent, and it's basically pulling with isometric tension on the other arm. So usually both arms are bent slightly. There are different variations on this, but it's an asymmetrical platform. Mm-hmm. When you compare that to the isosceles stance, where both arms are extended fully, well, your arms are always going to be the same length. So when you extend your arms and you essentially lock out your elbows or come close to locking out your elbows, and then you simply orient yourself with the thing that's trying to kill you, which is probably what you'll do anyway under stress, you simply point your entire body at whatever it is you want to shoot.
Right, right.
So when you think of things in simple terms, the isosceles stance is much more of a natural, instinctive, kinesthetic alignment of the gun than the Weaver stance would be, because it takes into consideration and builds upon your natural, instinctive reactions to stress.
So who is coming to your martial blade concepts seminars? I know I spoke with Alan Elishowitz recently, and he came to a 2 or 3 day seminar you had in Colorado recently. Who are the folks who come by these seminars?
In a lot of cases, what we'll have are people who have trained in other martial arts and have kind of gotten disillusioned with the traditional martial arts approach. The martial arts have gotten a lot better. But it used to be, if you think back to, you know, kind of the Karate Kid type of stuff, the wax on, wax off type of thing. We jokingly call it wax on, whack off, because it basically is martial masturbation. If you don't know what you're doing and you're simply going through the motions of a martial art with no clear understanding of what you're trying to achieve, you're wasting your time. You may be doing it for artistic purposes. You may enjoy doing it for, you know, the health benefits and everything else. But when it comes to self-defense, every movement that you do should have purpose, mm-hmm. and you should know what you're trying to achieve. So in many cases, what we have are people who've kind of been through that process and they're like, you know, I've trained for years, but I wasn't sure what this movement was for, or this technique didn't work. And they just really didn't feel that it was the shortest route to self-defense. Many of those folks also, the way I kind of consider self-defense, there's four pillars. So you essentially have your physical attributes. So your strength, your reflexes, essentially your athleticism. Then you have skill, so your actual combative skill. Then you have weapons, and then you have your mindset. Well, as we get older, what ends up happening, or if we get injured, our physical attributes diminish. Hopefully we've been training so our skills get better. But what ends up happening is people, when they're younger, it's like, okay, great, I've got physical attributes. I don't need that much skill. I've already got a bad attitude because I'm young. So the mindset is there. They don't need weapons, and they fight very well. Whatever you get out of the byproduct or the output of these four pillars, it's almost like an equalizer on a stereo. Whatever comes out at the end has to sound good. Well, in this case, it has to be hit that threshold of being able to defend yourself and be effective self-defense. Well, as folks get older, their physical attributes diminish. And at that point, they start looking at, well, I need to cheat. I need a weapon.
Mm-hmm.
If I get to that point where I'm up against, you know, some guy who's younger, stronger, maybe a couple of, you know, multiple attackers, something like that, they hit that point where they do some soul searching and realize I no longer have the physical attributes to fight empty-handed. And I need something to work as an equalizer. So in many cases, we'll have people who do that. We get a lot of shooters. In many cases, we'll have shooters who will show up and they'll have the knife in their left pocket. And it's like, well, you know, that's my weapon retention tool. So somebody goes for my gun, I'm going to use the knife to cut them off of it. It's like, okay, show me how you draw your folder and open it one-handed with your non-dominant hand. Ready, go.
While you're holding your pistol in with your
while
other hand.
While you're engaged in a tug of war over your pistol with the other arm. And that never goes well. And then they realize, oh, okay, you know, in many cases, what you'll have are people who have concealed carry permits, but don't carry on a regular basis. They're looking for a weapon that's more convenient mm-hmm. to carry. They travel to places. They've done the math and they figured out, I go to places where I don't have reciprocity. I go to places that are non-permissive environments where carry of a gun is not permitted. So they start looking at all these things. And it's usually people who've done some research, have done the math, and they look at it and say, you know what? The knife could be a viable option for me. So it's usually folks who've done a little bit of soul searching and a little bit of research to get there.
It's kind of a hard place to get to, I would imagine. I mean, I've always been a knife lover, and I've done Filipino martial arts for a while. But it's, I would imagine, it's a hard place to get to if you're if you're not necessarily an enthusiast about it and you don't think about it, or maybe the movements don't seduce you, or knives are not interesting to you, and it's just a practical thing. I could see how approaching knife combatives could be difficult because it's so visceral and personal.
It is, and it's also one of those things. When you look at shooters, they get used to simulating something that is a pretty brutal, gruesome thing, you know, shooting another human being.
Yeah.
But they basically boil that down to, I just put two holes in a piece of cardboard, and it's the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's not. So they've come up with this, you know, kind of very sterile clinical way of simulating something that they say, okay, at this point, I'm good to go because I got two shots in center mass. It's in the A zone. I'm good. When you start talking about, okay, I'm going to, you know, cut this guy and I'm going to cut to the bone. I'm going to cut his quad to the bone. I may take his femoral nerve and his femoral artery in the process. Even for shooters, that can be a little bit too much. But it's one of those things where, again, you have to be able to cross that mental gap, if you will, and say, okay, this is what I'm willing to do to defend myself.
Yeah. Yep.
Some people can do that, some people can't. Some people do it as a curiosity, and you know, as soon as we start getting into the realities of the mechanics, they find it off-putting. They'll go through the motions for the rest of the day and you never see them again.
So coming full circle, You train in Filipino martial arts and other styles, and you develop your own concepts, and then you develop your own knife, and you work with Spyderco. What has that been like?
It's been great. I just celebrated my 10th anniversary as a Spyderco employee.
Mm-hmm.
So I've actually been affiliated with Spyderco since 1999. I've known Sal Glesser since 1999. I started teaching for Spyderco back when NBC was kind of in its infancy back then. And it's been great, especially coming back, being a full-time employee with them. They were kind enough. I had been working with Blackhawk Products Group.
Mm-hmm.
I was managing both Masters of Defense and Blackhawk Blades. Essentially, they were prepping the company to sell it to a company called ATK. And one of the ways that they made their profitability look a little bit more attractive was to get rid of all the middle management. So when I got kicked to the curb from Blackhawk, I went to Spyderco and asked them if they, you know, had any opportunities, and they essentially created an opportunity for me.
Yeah.
And I'll always be grateful for that. They brought me on board, and essentially it's allowed me to continue to work in the cutlery industry, an industry I love, and also pursue teaching, writing. I have been doing the Best Defense TV series. I did 10 of the 11 seasons of the Best Defense under Spyderco sponsorship.
Wow.
So they've been very good to me.
The Be Warned knife. Was that you?
Yes.
Okay. That, I always thought that was cool looking.
How'd
too.
You guess?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. That's a, that's not Master of Defense. That's,
that was Blackhawk.
That's Blackhawk, right?
Okay.
It seems like, I've seen you in a number of the SHOT Show and, Blade Show videos, working at the Spyderco booth there. They just seem like an amazing outfit. I mean, how many different designers they bring into their mix, but also the innovation that comes out of that house. I was watching your video, a video you put up on the Yojimbo 2, and you were talking specifically about the compression lock and how optimized it is for, especially for a tactical knife or a knife you don't necessarily want to fold on your hands. Not that you want any two, but in a situation where you might be drawing the Yojimbo to actually do some of that kind of work, you're talking about the compression. What about the compression lock over, say, what people kind of consider its sister, but to me it's kind of the opposite, the liner lock? How do you differentiate?
So they both use a split liner, if you will, that basically is a spring that extends laterally across the thickness of the blade. The big difference when you think of a liner lock, which you've got, when you open it up, you're essentially looking at, if you hold it edge up, you're looking into the inside slot of the handle. The ramp on the blade faces toward the butt end of the handle. And essentially the liner is pressing up against that ramp. When you apply pressure to the blade to try to close it, what ends up happening is one of two things. One is either the ramp will slide completely off the blade, or if it starts to bow because it's not strong enough, it'll eventually give up and the blade will close. With a compression lock, it's a different mechanism as far as the vectors of force. So the ramp faces upward. So what I mean by that is, if you were to open the knife and you had it edged down and you're looking at it from the side, the ramp on the back of the blade faces upward instead. And it faces directly up toward the stop pin of the knife. So the stop pin is what, as you open the blade, essentially it keeps the blade from extending too far. It limits the travel of the blade. Well, when the liner comes across onto the ramp, what it's doing now is it's coming across onto the ramp itself, but the top of the liner is held captive by the stop pin. So the reason it's called a compression lock is when you try to apply pressure to close the blade, now what you're trying to do is not push the liner out of the way. You're actually trying to crush it between that upward facing ramp and the bottom of the stop pin. Mechanically, it's way stronger. So when you look at Spyderco does testing for all of its locks, locks that are what are called MBC rated. So MBC, the original MBC was actually Marshall Blade Craft, which is a term that Sal Glesser coined. When I left or stopped teaching for Spyderco and went to work for Blackhawk, I changed my MBC to Marshall Blade Concepts so I could maintain the acronym, not have any conflict of interest there. But something that is MBC rated, according to Spyderco, holds 200 inch pounds of pressure per inch of blade length. So basically, at that strength, it's very difficult for the human hand to hold on to it and apply that much pressure. So the compression lock is one of the few locks that is MBC rated, and the Yojimbo is MBC rated, and it exceeds 200 inch pounds of pressure per inch of blade length. It also puts the lock release into the soft part of the web of the thumb. So when you're gripping the knife, you can grip it as tight as you want, and there's no danger of accidentally releasing the lock. Whereas with a liner lock, especially if it has a cutout that allows you to release the lock, your index finger typically rests right on the lock release. So if the knife twists in your hand at all, it's very easy, not for the lock to give up, but for you to actually inadvertently release the lock and let it close on your fingers.
So basically, to get a compression lock to fail, you would have to have you would have to be strong enough in your hands, A, to hold on to it, B, while that small piece of liner that is spring-loaded as the lock is being crushed between the blade tang and the stop pin, which seems kind of impossible, or not impossible, but certainly impossible to hold on to while that's happening.
Yeah, whatever you would be doing with the knife in your hand at that point, the odds of you losing your grip, the knife slipping out of your hand and you letting go completely, are a lot higher than you actually compromising the lock.
Okay, so I'm going to ask you, what other knives, obviously the Yojimbo 2 is the knife. That's the one you've designed, and you've designed that to your specs. What out there, if you can think of one, what other knives call to you in such a way that you would want to use them in such a situation?
When people ask me about what are the best knives for self-defense, you have all these different knives out there, my first answer is find a knife that has a matching trainer so you can actually train and develop skill. That narrows the field tremendously.
Radically, yeah.
I mean, you probably are down now to about 1% to 2% of all so-called tactical knives out there. So when you really want to narrow the field, that's the quickest way to do it, because now it's like, if I actually want to train, which you should, of course, if you're going to rely on something as a defensive weapon, you have to have a training tool that matches it. So once you pare everything down, one of my favorites is the Spyderco Delica. I've carried Delicas and Enduras for years and years and years. The Delica is still my back pocket knife. It's one of the three knives I carry every day, two Yojimbos and a Delica. So the Delica Warncliffe is one of my go-tos. So once that came out in a Warncliffe profile, the old Saber Ground one went away, and that one jumped in my pocket.
That's funny. I'm not surprised. That's a cool looking, that Delica with that. I love the way that looks. I don't have one, but with that swoop down towards the tip, it's beautiful.
Yep. And again, it's the same cutting mechanics. It's the same logic and everything else, simply applied to a little bit different platform. And with the Delica, what's nice about it, again, for left-handers, the fact that it's a back lock, operation is completely ambidextrous. There's a four-position clip, so you can easily set it up for left-side carry.
You can get it waved if you want, or you can put a zip tie on there if you want.
Yep, or the Have you seen the 5x5 combat solutions there, bolt-on? Mm-mm. They call it a pickpocket. It's basically a screw-on wave.
Oh, nice.
They do a really nice job of those. The machining is really nicely done. So they're doing those for Delicas and Enduras as well.
Nice. Well, so, Michael, if people want to get in touch with you, find out where you're giving seminars, find out more about you, more about your knives and your designs, where should they go?
Best place to go is MarshallBladeConcepts.com. So Marshall, like martial arts, BladeConcepts.com. And that is my website. The way that it's organized, it'll kind of take you to all the different things that you might be interested in. So if you are interested in DVDs, it can point you to my DVDs, which are sold through Stay Safe Media. If you're looking for digital videos online, it'll point you there. If you're looking for the seminar schedule, if you're looking for, I also have a complete instructor locator. So I have an instructor certification program in NBC. Of course, the best way to learn any martial art is through regular training with a certified instructor. So if you go to the instructor locator, it's broken down by country and state. So if you are in New York and you're looking for, you know, I want to find an NBC instructor, simply scroll down to New York. You look to see who's available there and figure out who's close to you.
And I would also be remiss if I didn't ask you, do you have any other knife concepts or knife designs in the hopper that you're working on? You don't have to, like, bust them out right here, but are you working on another knife? People are so happy with this Yojimbo 2.
Well, first of all, for folks who are fixed blade fans, in addition to the Yojimbo 2, there is the Ronin 2. So there is a fixed blade version of that that is literally the same exact profile. Not quite as pointy a peak at the top, but that is a fixed blade version of the same design. And I guess I can talk about it now because there's been some talk about it on the forums and stuff. I've had some people come back to me and say, I love the Yojimbo, but I've got really big hands and I need something that's going to fit my hand better. Can you make a bigger version? So I've designed a bigger version and basically they asked me what I wanted to call it. So I'm calling it the Yojumbo.
The Yojumbo. That's awesome. All right.
A little tongue in cheek.
But perfect. Okay, so the Yojimbo, like I said, one of my absolute favorite knives and definitely my favorite Spyderco knife. But I also love big knives, so I cannot wait for the Yojumbo. What kind of blade length are you thinking?
It's going to be right around 4 inches.
Yes. So
it's about 3/4 of an inch longer
than
the Yojimbo. And tried to make the ergonomics so it'll fit normal size hands, but it'll also easily accommodate bigger hands as well.
That's cool. And one of the things, one of the greatest improvements, I think, from the Yojimbo to the Yojimbo 2 was the blade to handle ratio, which I know you've also definitely considered because you like this to be kind of a, when in closed position, to serve as a sort of makiwara or a little hand stick thing, but also be able to open up. But you don't want too much extra handle without the blade. Because that's just what people will.
Again, if you go back to the first generation, there's an interesting historical perspective that goes along with that. So when I was designing the first generation Yojimbo, what I wanted was something that would fit my hand, give me the ability to strike with the puño, the butt of the weapon. But also at that time, this was pre-September 11th. So at that time, FAA regulations were that you could carry a 4-inch blade on a plane under heightened security. They reduced it to 3 inches. So I did the research on the FAA regulations and I said, okay, I'm going to do a 3-inch blade, but I want to make sure that I have a full size handle. So when you look at the first generation Yojimbo, people are like, what the hell's wrong with this thing? You know, there's not enough blade. Again, it was designed pre-September 11th. It wasn't released until after that, but it was designed prior to that time and it was designed specifically to allow you to be able to carry it on a plane at that time with those regulations. Of course, the world has changed drastically since
the good old days.
But, you know, that's, again, it's like anything else. A little bit of historical perspective goes a long way. And a lot of cases helps you understand things a lot better.
Well, Michael Janich, thank you so much for coming on the Knife Junkie podcast. I appreciate it. It's been great speaking with you. You've been on my radar. I've been watching your videos and buying your designs for years. And I was very excited to talk to you. So, it's been a pleasure, sir.
It's been a pleasure for me as well. Thank you so much for the opportunity.
Absolutely.
Ever visit the knives online in the hopes of satisfying your need to possess them in the real world? then you have a problem. You are a knife junkie.
Back on the Knife Junkie Podcast, episode 58, another one in the books. Great interview with Michael Janich. And, for the knife newbie guy here, definitely a different interview, for me, getting more into the, as you said, the analytical and that kind of thing.
Yeah, I guess some of these conversations can get, it can make the squeamish run for cover, and I'm not calling you squeamish, but no. I mean, it's not often we talk about bleeding, even though this is a knife show. But the way Michael Janich comes at it, it's not torrid at all. He's not fantasizing about getting in knife fights. He's talking about the actual realities that people, especially law enforcement officers, have to deal with, and how the knife can actually play into it. And what better way to approach something as emotionally fraught and just sort of mysterious as a quote-unquote knife fight. Best approach it from the most analytical and most scientific angle as possible. Mm-hmm. I thought it was fascinating kind of deconstructing the Fairbairn-Sykes, the sort of model, the get-tough model. You get hit in the carotid, you bleed out in 13 seconds, that's it, lights out, and actually demystifying some of that stuff. So basically, I really admire him for his sort of research and his analytical approach to this thing that could be a very intense and emotional experience.
Before we wrap up, I'd like to remind you that if you're shopping for a knife and you want to save some money, we've got a way for you to do so. If you'll just go to thenifejunkie.com/ebates, that way you can save money anytime you buy a knife or really buy anything online. The use of Ebates actually allows you to earn cash back for all of your purchases, stuff you're buying already or special purchases that you want to use. So just go to thenifejunkie.com/Ebates, sign up for free. The next time you're shopping, remember to use Ebates, thenifejunkie.com/Ebates, thenifejunkie.com/Ebates. Bob? Knife Junkie Podcast, episode number 58 in the books. Mm-hmm. Final quick word from you.
Go out and check out a Warncliffe. If you don't have one, if you don't have one in your collection, check out a Yojimbo 2 or any other kind of Warncliffe-y blade and see how useful they actually are.
There, you heard it. As I say, knife drop from the Knife Junkie. We're out of here.
Thanks for listening to the Knife Junkie Podcast. If you enjoyed the show, please rate and review at reviewthepodcast.com. For show notes for today's episode, additional resources, and to listen to past episodes, visit our website, thenifejunkie.com. You can also watch our latest videos on YouTube at thenifejunkie.com/YouTube. Check out some great knife photos on thenifejunkie.com/Instagram and join our Facebook group at thenifejunkie.com/Facebook. And if you have a question or comment, email them to bob@thenifejunkie.com or call our 24/7 listener line at 724-466-4487, and you may hear your comment or question answered on an upcoming episode of the Knife Junkie Podcast.